That's no moon! That's an asshole!
It wasn't a phase.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Scenior Citizen Podcast. We are here with a super special guest today. We got AJ and Tony from Werewolves.
What's up?
How are you?
For the record, and I wanted to make it loud and clear for audio-only people, too, I'm a vampire girly.
Yeah.
So how did this werewolf cult thing start?
Traitor!
First of all, I like my boys shiny, too.
Okay. You like your shiny boys?
Sparkly.
I like my boys sparkly. Okay.
I grew up a huge fan of, like, two movies as a child. I was really, like, super into An American Werewolf in London. That was the first horror movie my parents ever let me see. I was, like, age four. But, like, on the opposite end of that, my favorite film of all time was, like, at that period was Teen Wolf with Michael J. Fox.
Mm-hmm.
So you have this counterbalance of, you know, the world's most terrifying werewolf versus, like, the werewolf you want to, like, play basketball with.
Yeah.
So it was marrying those two things together that kind of, like, I always had this name in the back of my head, and I always knew, like, I had, like, a huge connection to, like, those two things. So when it came time to form this project, and I didn't have anybody telling me I couldn't do anything that I wanted to do, I just went with, like, that's the name. Werewolves.
It's just werewolves.
Funny, but terrifying at the same time.
It's punny. It's one of those names that when you hear it, you're like, it's catchy. I like it. Like, it sticks to you, too. It's not like one of those, like, band names. It's
favorite,
what was our name again?
My favorite thing on the planet is listening to other people say our name.
So it's...
How would you say it?
Well, I already know it's werewolves.
Okay.
Werewolves.
But the first time I saw it spelled, I was like, ooh.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the funniest question we get is, how do you say your name? Is it werewolves, werewolves? The answer is yes.
Yes. Or no, my favorite is we're...
We are wolves.
It's like
no.
You see those things together, and then you all of a sudden, it's like you forget how to say we're. Yeah.
Fair enough.
I always have to tell people, like, we're here. We're here right now.
We're wolves. Right.
Yeah.
I just want to say, and I'm going to speak for my mother on that behalf, anybody who's not a native English speaker is going to hate that.
Oh, yeah. 100%.
Oh, yeah. She's probably like, what the
fuck? Drew says it fine. He's like, straight up Colombian.
Well, he's been trained.
That's true. He has been trained.
So Teen Wolf, was that the MTV one?
No.
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 Okay.
It's a 1985 film starring Michael J. Fox.
Oh, okay.
Where it's basically the entire film is just like a metaphor for puberty, but it's hysterical.
Oh, basically like...
It didn't age well, I'll say that much. There's a lot of jokes in there that did not age well.
Basically like the Turning Red of back in the day, if you watched Turning Red recently.
I have no idea what that is.
Oh my gosh, Turning Red is this film, Disney animated.
Okay.
It's about this little girl that basically she turns into a red fox, and it's just an analogy of her getting her period and going through puberty.
Yeah, no, it's exactly that, except there's some very off-color jokes in that, in the original. But that was the 80s.
Well, this one's politically correct, and 2020s.
Oh, and that's
2020s Disney. Of course it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Of course it is.
Yeah.
But anyways, did this group start off with Tony in it, or did he join somewhere
along
the way?
I'm the fifth lead guitar player.
You're the fifth?
I'm the only original member of this band.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay. Why so much turnover?
Because motherfuckers be sneaky.
Fair enough.
There's a lot of people who present themselves as something that they're not, or present themselves as a team player and they're not, and some people get convoluted on what their actual intentions are for a project like that. And some people are just straight up greedy. So I've had those moments. I mean, I was having a conversation with, we've been trying out his friend as like a fill-in, you know, could potentially work out. And I was telling him basically, like, we had like an incident come up. And I was like, hey, look, I hate being this guy, but I know this one person, and it's like, I can't have toxicity in this project. Like, I can't. Like, this is my happy place, this is my creative place, and I just can't have that around me. So, like, I try to, like, distance myself away from everything that distracts me from this band. So, and I've had several distractions over the course of the few years. Sadly, though, one of our really, really good friends, we're very happy for him. He was the last member to leave. He decided that he wanted to, you know, go to school and stuff like that. And, you know, we're very proud of him. So out of that entire batch of humans that have been in this project, that's like my only friend that left and that broke my heart.
Fair. And it's hard to make
the
friends.
Only one that left on semi-decent terms.
We're on great right. terms.
Or great we're terms. Like,
great terms. Yeah, he could come back if he wanted to.
The only one that left on great terms, we'll put it that way.
Yeah. I mean, he can come out and play guitar sometime, but right. he'll never be in this band again.
Oh, wow. Okay.
I love him. I love him, but, you know, if you can't give 100%, then I don't want you.
Fair enough. Fair enough. And it's hard to find people who are dedicated and actually care about what you do as much as you do.
It's almost next to impossible, but I've seen to find, like, at least three other dudes that put up with my shit and let me be the creative weirdo that I am.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think the first test of our friendship was going to Ohio for a week. And then literally we were at our friend and co-producer's house, and we stayed at his house. Jesse and Drew got a hotel, but we were literally writing and around each other for 18 hours a day for 6 days straight. And that really was a testament of like, okay, so this is what we have to look forward to in a tour environment where we can't separate from each other.
Well, right. Not even just that. It was a really cool way. It was that was my my water. It was a really cool way to kind of see what everybody's dynamics was, and it kind of did single out our friend who ended up leaving. Because mm-hmm. you could, when you're in that kind of environment, when you're stuck in a different state for 6 days writing a record, it's one of those things like you can kind of see who's doing what, who's doing where, who's in this, and who's detached from it.
Right.
So it was kind of foreshadowing what would later come. But, I mean, me and these three guys have so far been through some crazy stuff, and we're all still here smiling with each other, so that's a good sign.
Mm-hmm.
How did you get in the band, Tony? Was it just auditions, or...?
No, so I started... So my story with this band is actually pretty cool. So I met them for the very first time at a show. I went to support my boys in Happy Hour at a show at Culture Room. It was Werewolves, Happy Hour, Hometown Losers, and Fame on Fire. And I had no idea who any of them were except Happy Hour. And I saw them that night, befriended them, started showing up for their other shows, started helping out on music videos. And then it got to a point where he didn't even know I could play guitar at the time.
No idea.
And he just, I guess the need arose for a new guitar player, and he saw me playing on Instagram or something. He goes, oh shit, like this dorky, lovable kid is also a guitar player. And he just texted me like, hey, do you want to join? I'm like, okay. And the rest is history.
Yeah, I had this keen sense. I've been doing this for a long time, so I can usually tell when someone's starting to exhibit signs that they're on their way out.
Yeah.
And let me say that I have not fired anybody from this band. They have left on their own terms. So it's one of those things where I can usually tell when someone's like close. So I was like, I was sitting on Instagram one day and he popped up, and I saw him shredding on guitar, and I was like, holy, what? And I messaged him and I was like, you wouldn't be interested in this, would you? I'm like, I have a feeling that this one dude's about to leave. I'm going to send you some songs. Why don't you learn them and show me that you can play them?
Fast forward a month later, we're literally two practices in, and he puts it in the group chat, hey, do you guys want to open for We the Kings, Red Jumpsuit Apparatus and Hawthorne Heights?
That's insane.
So my first show with this band was in front of over 1,000 people. No pressure.
That's so exciting.
Well, it was also like everyone's first big show post-lockdown. Mm-hmm. So even though like we were the second or third band to go on, you know, everyone showed up early because they had been show deprived for the last like year and a half.
And what'd you do the following year?
The following year? Oh, we opened up for The Used and Story of the Year and also Red Jumpsuit. We played with Red
Berlin.
And Amberlin, yeah. We've played with Red Jumpsuit like four times now. Mm-hmm. Something like that.
Yeah, four times.
I think like four times. They're great dudes.
They're really good dudes.
But
the only Red Jumpsuit Apparatus song I know is probably like the most basic
one. That's the one that everybody knows.
Yeah.
Everyone knows Face Down and Your Guardian Angel.
Basically, yeah. So two songs, yay.
Yeah. You didn't even know you knew that other one.
Yeah. No, it was in the back of my mind. It lives rent-free.
Yeah,
rent-free. It's always on.
That entire album was really good, though. Yeah. If you haven't listened to it, start to finish, treat yourself.
I probably have to go back and do that.
Yeah, it's really such a good record.
I love how you came across werewolves, whatever. because there is a certain magic on stage. I have to congratulate you guys. I saw you guys at the Saving Vice show.
Oh, cool. That was a better show because he wasn't dying.
Yeah, yeah. But
he wasn't wearing a sweat at that show. You were at the show, right? Yeah, obviously.
Yes.
Yeah. So he wasn't wearing a sweatband on stage to like say to look cool. Like, but although you did have like kind of a Motley Crue-ish kind of vibe, kind of gave me like an Nikki Six thing.
No, that sweatband actually serves.
That was to keep him.
That sweatband serves a different purpose because my in ears keep falling out every time I headbang, so I pull it over my ears now. And it looked ridiculous at first, our buddy Miguel, who was filling in on rhythm, because when we go to the shows, we're not wearing like our stage shirts at the time.
Yeah.
And when I changed into it, and he saw like it was black, black, white, black, 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 Miguel was like, "Okay, I get it. It looks decent now." Right. And with my hair down, it looks less ridiculous too, because when I have it bunned up and then I've got a sweatband, it looks like. Are you off to some, like, yoga class? Like, who the fuck are you?
I've been there. Don't shame the yoga classes. No, I wasn't at the show last week, but I was at the Saving My show. But I did see pictures of the headband, and I'm glad to know the backstory behind it now. Because I was like, oh, that looks cool. That's
it's
different.
It's functional.
Right?
But it's functional, so that's
like
cool.
That becomes a thing for him.
Right.
I'm not gonna lie. I mean, I kind of dug it, dude.
I don't know about you guys, but, like, when sweat gets into your eyes,
that's the worst, too.
Yeah.
That's another.
Especially sweat with makeup.
Moisturizer. Ooh. The second moisturizer gets into your eyes, game over. Rest of the day. I can't even wear my contacts.
When I first met you, you were wearing like a green bandana on stage. I still have old photos of it.
Yeah, it was much easier, but I can't wear the bandanas now. I tried to do it before one of our shows, and I just kept like thinking like I look like a washed up hair metal singer. Like I'm not. I look like Bret Michaels, but with actual hair. So I was like, I can't do this.
What I was getting to is there's a certain magic on stage, and my like core memory from that show is that I don't remember what song it was that you started singing. It's from the album, and you pointed at me, and I'm like, I didn't know the song, and I'm like, what the fuck do you want me to do? Christina, you know Christina Las Claus?
Yes.
She pushes me to the front, and I'm like, I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing here.
Oh. I think that was Possession. It was probably Possession.
Maybe.
It was either Possession or... For Saving Vice, yeah, we were. It was either Possession or Titanium, because that's one of the higher songs. So he tends to like do the audience participation a little bit more.
It's funny because if I see someone get like, I didn't know you got pushed up. I just saw someone come up real quick to the front. I was like, oh, cool, probably wants to sing with me. And then I'm like, nope, denied.
Don't know the words. I'll make my own karaoke out of it.
Fine. You can sing whatever you want in there. No one's gonna know. It honestly, like when you watch playback videos, it sounds like, like, and you're like, yeah, just do that.
Right.
Just say watermelon. No one's gonna know the difference that you don't know the actual words.
And now that you mentioned that, I'd probably just start singing the Harry Styles.
You can do that. Was that watermelon sugar?
Yeah.
Just do that. Yeah. It doesn't matter.
All right.
It really doesn't.
My best karaoke voice.
You don't even have to hit the right note.
What's your guys' go-to karaoke song?
I avoid karaoke at this point.
My wife showed a video of me when I was, like, really drunk, and this was, like, back when I was a drinker, and apparently my favorite karaoke, my go-to karaoke song is Getting Jiggy With It by Will Smith, because I know every word to that song, and I only want to do it when I've had a couple drinks.
The best thing is when you don't have to look at the machine.
Yeah, no, I didn't.
Right.
I don't look at
yeah,
it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's in here.
That's me with Dancing Queen.
Yeah, it's right in here. I don't need...
I've not done karaoke in a hot minute, but I think the last time I did it was...
Hot.
It was probably Panic at the Disco song or something like that.
Ooh, fair enough.
Which one? Out of the entire...
It was either I Write Sins or Death of a Bachelor.
Sweet. Oh, well, those are two very different vibes.
Mm-hmm. Right?
I can go Sinatra with it. You're not used to hearing that side of me.
I'm not used to hearing that side. I would love to hear that side of you.
Now that we're mentioning Panic, I'm going to go back into basically what, you know, the foundation of the show is, and it's the nostalgia of growing up in the scene and being an emo kid. And I know that neither of you are going to let me down. I know that both of you had to have cringy set lists as a teen.
Oh, yeah, very much so.
So what was it like being bullied growing up?
No one bullied me because I was a foot and a half taller than everybody and they knew better.
Fair enough.
I don't know, I'm kind of like an old man, so like, bullying was just like a thing. It gave you character. I don't know. I never really mind being bullied.
No,
it just was like, someone would say like something real mean and I go, oh, okay, well, I guess I'm going to work on that. And then I just did that. I don't know, that's always been my mentality.
It's the only motherfucker that took bullying as constructive criticism.
Right?
Honestly, so when people are like, can you handle constructive criticism? Like, fucking fired at me.
You would have thrived in a Latin household, by the way.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I still don't, I'm 25, I still don't take it well.
Our bass player's whole family has adopted me.
Yeah.
I take it. I'm just like, cool,
I still don't.
Yeah.
It's bad. No. It's awful. Terrible. Oh. Too sensitive for that.
Well, I'm Italian, so like I'm used to people being shitty to each other.
But anyways, what did you guys listen to in that era of your life? What was that music that kind of got you into doing music?
My older brother introduced me to Escape the Fate when I was like 11 or 12. And I have this fond memory of we had gone to Universal, and I think in Universal there was like this water tower or something that had like a music video playing on it. Mm-hmm. And I don't know if it's actually a thing, but for some reason it's up here in my memory. And the music video for something was playing on that little tower thing.
Is that the name of the song? Or
yeah,
is
that, okay. That was the name of the song. All right. It was like the first Craig Mabbit album. It was like the poppiest song on that album.
Yeah, I was gonna say that's Mabbit era.
Yeah, Mabbit era.
Probably the only era. One of the only songs I liked from that era.
I'm gonna text Craig right now and be like, you know that you're an era.
I mean, he's on.
I thrived off the Escape the Fate drama. Okay, Ronnie Radke going to jail.
I was one of the few from like the very beginning was like, look, you guys can like both of them. There's nothing wrong with it. And then when the Bury the Hatchet tour happened, I was so excited. And I was this close to convincing my mom to let me go because I was like 13 or 14 at the time. And then the Atlanta show sold out, so I didn't get the chance to see it. But fast forward a few years later, they went on tour. It was Falling in Reverse, Escape the Fate, and The Word Alive, which is an even cooler, like, full circle moment if you know the backstory of The Word Alive. That was my last show that I went to before lockdown.
Oh, wow.
Were you in the band?
I was not in the band yet.
Okay. I did see you there.
You did see me there. Yeah. That was February of 2020. Mm-hmm. I didn't join until February of 2021.
Can you enlighten me with the backstory of The Word Alive, how that fits in?
So, the first time that Ronnie got kicked out and they flew Craig out to audition, Craig actually stood up for Ronnie and was like, look, it's very hard to replace a singer, you know, because he had just stepped in for, or someone else had just stepped in for Bless the Fall, and he had seen, like, how much shit he was getting, so he was like, hey, give him another chance. So they flew him back home, and he started The Word Alive, and then, like, a month and a half later, they called him again and said, hey, we need you, you know, Ronnie's going to prison. And he's like, all right. The Word Alive was starting to take themselves very seriously. They didn't want to be like a side project, so that's when they brought in Telly, who's been their lead singer the entire time. But The Word Alive started as Craig's side project before he got brought back to Escape. Mm. So Craig has, like, it's like this inner circle thing for that tour. It was Falling in Reverse, Escape the Fate, and The Word Alive all touring together, which had never happened before. So it was like, if you knew the backstory of, like, Craig and Ronnie and Telly, it was like a really cool moment to see them all together.
That's really cool, actually.
Yeah. It was a great show. It was the only show I've ever been to for that genre that only had three bands playing.
We all learned a thing just now.
Yeah. Right? Mm-hmm. And that's what I'm the first person to say I don't know. Because I'm not going to sit here and pretend I know something when I don't. So that's very cool. Very full circle. I didn't hate Craig Mabbit. He just didn't, like, I don't know. It didn't fit in the band for me. It lost what it was with Ronnie. And when Ronnie came back with Falling in Reverse with that first album, had it on repeat for as long as I can remember.
I remember I was talking to Craig, and I looked him dead in the eye, and I was like, I really like Dead Rabbits. we were playing with him, and I'm just like, that's it. I said what I said. I really like Dead Rabbit. It's a good band.
That was it, yeah.
Yeah, that was it. Move on. Carry Fair on. Enough. I'm a Ronnie boy.
Yeah.
That's true. Been a Ronnie man since I heard that. What's that one song? Broke the phones inside my fist, but I'm okay.
Oh, Raised by Wolves?
No. It's
no.
Raised by Wolves. It's
That's by... There's No Sympathy for the Dead.
Yeah.
It's off of first EP, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So the original version, yeah, the one on the EP. Yeah. I remember hearing that first and going like, I love this guy's voice. And yeah. I've just been Team Ronnie the entire time.
I think that's why a lot of people gravitated toward Falling in Reverse, you know, when everything first went down, because Drugging Me As You, a lot of people saw as like a great sequel to Dying Is Your Latest Fashion.
Oh, it is.
Just kind of made sense as a sequel. So for anybody that loved that record, the follow up would have made sense to have been, you know, Drugging Me As You.
Right.
I think a few people took it a little bit too far. It was like, oh, like, I have to hate escape the fate now just because I like this, which is fucking stupid.
Right, right. And it goes even into genres too, where people are like, oh, if I listen to this, I can't listen to that. And I think we all kind of went through a little bit of that as a teen, but now as an adult, it's like, give me that 2010s playlist that's all over the place. It's great.
even as a teen, you know, growing up in the Atlanta scene, you know, and I've said this 1,000 times, but like the Atlanta scene that I was used to seeing, it was a brotherhood. You showed up for me, I showed up for you. Mm-hmm. Because there's no competition. You know, to put it this way, Asking Alexandria and Capture the Crown are basically the same band. One of them's just from England, the other one's from Australia. But if you listen to them, like some of their older shit, they sound literally identical. People will still like both of them.
Right.
There's no competition. There's nothing saying you can't like two different bands.
Well, that's because one makes the sound, and then 100 copies of that come out, and maybe 4 of them become successful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Usually how it works.
Yeah.
Usually. You see it happen. As soon as you hear a new sound, like Kim Dracula's out, so there's going to be like 12 other people trying to sound like Kim Dracula.
Right, and one of those will
get close.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Speaking of brotherhoods and stuff, around the scene in general, I hear that you give a lot of people opportunities, AJ. Like, you gave Chris his opportunity, Christopher White Fox, to shoot his first show.
I just love Chris.
And they're super grateful for you.
Shout out to Chris. I love you, Chris.
You better watch these, Chris. What the fuck?
Let's make that the soundbite.
Right.
I love Chris White Fox.
I'll put that in there. Xavier also looks up to you a lot.
Cool.
How does it feel to be like a little bit of a leader in some way?
Forced into it. I didn't ask for it. I don't know.
But it's your responsibility now.
It is a responsibility. I don't know. I just do stuff, and then people tell me it's cool, and I go. Or they ask me advice, and I try to give it to them. I try to keep it as like 100% as possible, because I don't like to be bullshitted. I don't want to bullshit anybody. So I don't know. I don't really think about that. I know I'm a leader in this band because I made them tell me that I was. Because I was like, listen, if I'm going to do all this stuff, I need you to give me the power.
Right.
You know, I need the He-Man sword. I need to know that I have it. Otherwise, I'm going to feel like an asshole if I go to you and I tell you what to do. So tell me it's okay to tell you what to do, and then I will do that. It's like Ninja Turtles. Like, my favorite Ninja Turtle is Raphael, right? I'm not a Raphael. I'm unfortunately a Leonardo. And it's cool. I don't mind it. Someone has to be that guy.
Thankfully, none of us are Raphaels and feel the need to do our own thing out of spite.
Now,
I am not entirely that familiar with the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
It's pretty easy to tell who each one is. You
right.
got the fun guy, you got the nerd, you got the sarcastic, crude one, and then you got the leader.
Okay.
They're really easy to define roles, and yes, we see some of ourselves in all of those characters. That's why they're beloved.
I'm gonna go watch the movie now, so I can, because I don't know their personalities. The closest thing I got to really delving into the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle universe is like way back in the day there was an arcade Dreamcast game.
Okay.
Never got to beat it either. We would always die before the end, me and my brother.
Have you watched the original movie now?
Probably, I just don't remember it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're going to go and you're going to watch the 1991? 91?
It's
around there, yeah. It's one of those. I want to say it's 90.
Is that Vanilla Ice?
Yeah, no, Vanilla Ice is number 2, which I know is 92, or it might be 91. I don't know now. Now I'm questioning everything that I know to be true. But to circle back, yes, please go watch that.
Because
then you'll be like, I understand that conversation I forgot.
I need you guys to go on stage with, their respective colors now, with bandanas, please.
We need to do something interesting for this year's Halloween. I haven't decided what we're going to do yet, but that could be fun.
Ninja Turtle backpacks?
That could be fun. We make Miguel Casey Jones, because technically he's not like a Ninja Turtle. Yeah, see? That's what's up. That was terrible.
Just have him wear
completely
a fucking...
Missed.
We have no coordination together.
You're on my left side. Fuck it.
Yeah, that's true. Is Masset?
Yes.
Yes, he has one eye. So, I'm on the wrong.
You're
side.
On the wrong side.
I'm on the wrong side.
You're
of
in
knuckles.
His blind spot.
I'm in his blind spot.
I can't see you over there.
Yeah.
But he trusts you enough to have you in his blind spot.
Because I am his Sandra Bullock.
Right, the blind side. All right. All the shit that went down with that recently too. We're not gonna get into that.
No, absolutely
not.
But to circle back to the question before, because I have to do that with them, it probably. Because this is like what I put everything, all of my focus into is this band. I guess that kind of comes out, and I don't mean it to, like, I'm not trying to actively be a leader for everybody, mm-hmm. but, like, because I have to run this as a leader, like, it just comes out, and people respect it. Because, like, they can see the hustle. People respect hustle.
Right. And when I say leader, I don't mean someone who's necessarily bossing people around. But mm-hmm. it's just like you hand out, you give your hand when you can, you know.
Yeah.
And I respect that, too. Because mm-hmm. I live with the same philosophy. I don't like to be bullshitted. I get people mm-hmm. who ask me that are still, like, in school for journalism. And they're like, how do you do that? And it's like, it happens. Easy. I mean, do you want a PR content?
Yeah.
I mean, that's it. Like,
yeah, it's not easy to juggle so much stuff.
It's not. But yeah, that's since he had mentioned Brotherhood, I wanted to jump into that. But I need to know what was on your playlist when you were a teenager.
Oh, man. shit. Well, I know one of the bands that majorly influenced me getting into heavier music. It'd have to be Metallica.
Okay.
So even though I know that's such, like, an old man question, it's like Metallica led me into finding, like, Rob Zombie, finding White Zombie, finding Slipknot, which, you know, later led me into more post-hardcore-y stuff, or, like, you know, your friends show you, like, Blink-182. Like, we all like Blink-182. Like, at some point, we went through a Blink-182 fan's phase.
Yeah.
You know, as, you know, all your body starts developing, and you're in high school, you're like, these songs are just, you're getting it right.
What do you
now.
Mean, dude? No one liked me when I was 23.
Exactly. Yeah, true. No, I was a real piece
I went
of
through
shit
the 23. I went through the Green Day phase. I didn't really respect Blink until much
you know
later.
What's great? I think I made, like, a list.
You have a list?
Yeah, I meant to post. I just, like, my phone's just, I always make notes.
Oh,
I'm
God.
Like obsessive about making notes.
I think that's what people's brains look like, their
this
notes
is,
app, and that's
yeah.
concerning.
Yeah, it's mostly just, like, business stuff and random lyrics, and it's mostly, like, just, like, journaling.
My playlist as a teenager was centered around what I enjoyed learning, because I started learning guitar at an age of 9, so that kind of shaped, you know, what I was listening
yeah.
to. So it was
right.
a lot of Green Day, Sum 41, and then eventually Avenged Sevenfold, Black Veil, you know. I mean, it was mainly like...
Wait, did you write it down like this?
No.
We
yeah.
got
He's
Rob
weird.
Zombie, we got Slipknot, we got Metallica, we got Limp Bizkit, we got Papa Roach, Linkin Park... I see the Linkin Park. That song where you pointed at me, I was like, that feels Linkin Park-ish.
Mm-hmm.
Not exactly, but you know.
The honorable mentions get real colorful, though.
Yeah, we got honorable mentions. AFI, Blink-182, Alice Cooper, Third Eye Blind, Don Broke. They were lit. I saw
They're
them.
Awesome.
Yeah.
NSYNC, I think, is in there, too.
NSYNC, yes.
And the Backstreet Boys, but
right.
I don't think they made the listicle.
And then we got From First to Last, but Skrillex got no respect.
OG. From First to Last was my shit.
It was so,
so good.
Yeah.
I went through a period from, like, age 5 to age 8 where every time I got in the car with my parents, I only wanted to listen to one of two albums. It was either Hybrid Theory from Linkin Park
mm-hmm.
or Fallen from Evanescence.
Okay.
I fell in love with Amy Lee at, like, 5 years old.
Those are great bands,
mm-hmm.
and I feel like they're safe bands, because I listen to some crim shit, but when you tell people, like, oh, Linkin Park and Evanescence, they're like, oh yeah, you're good,
mm-hmm.
you're on the decent side of things.
They're safe.
Yeah.
They're, yeah.
It's like meeting somebody over 35 and saying Metallica, and they're like, yeah.
My brother.
Uh-huh.
My brother. What was it? I told my brother, I was like, I'm gonna go see my favorite band, they're playing for free, blah, 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 and he's like, is Guns N' Roses coming down? I want to see them. And I'm like, you fucking boomer.
I was really bummed out that I didn't get to see Guns N' Roses because they got washed out at, was that Rockville?
It was Rockville,
oh,
yeah.
Oh, they got washed out?
Disappointing.
No, like half the show got washed out when we went there last year.
Damn.
It was a bummer.
It was worth it for Kiss, though.
Oh, yeah.
This is amazing.
Kiss was the first night, and, well, it was Papa Roach and then Kiss
yes,
the first night.
Which was awesome.
Awesome.
Back.
Yeah. Very interesting back-to-back choice, but it worked very, very well. And then I think it was the second night that got rained out, like, halfway through.
Mm-hmm.
Third night, I think we finished that night with We Came as Romans, and they were playing,
oh, wow.
like, in the rain, which was so cool.
It was pretty dope.
It was pretty dope.
It was not safe, but it was dope.
That's crazy.
They got, like, 3 songs in, and they're, like, midway through their 3rd song when the red alert goes on. They're like, no, we ain't stopping. We're finishing this song at least.
Yeah, I watched John 5. up there shredding on stage, and he has like this mascot that comes out that's like a giant head of his on like someone's body walking around. Mm-hmm. And in the middle of his shred, they're like, "I'm gonna cut it." Jump, I was just like,
"Down with the giant head running around."
It's awesome.
Well, I was disappointed I didn't get to see Skillet that year because they're I would say they're a guilty pleasure, but I don't feel like
heavily Christian.
Gosh. No, one of my best friends of like almost 20 years introduced me to like Skillet, Red, Thousand Foot Crutch, because that was like that era of Christian rock bands where like it was secular enough where even if you weren't a Christian, you still could really dig it.
Right.
They are a little too preachy for me now, but like, no, Awake and Comatose are banger albums, even if you're like, because they're just, you can listen to it and there's not a whole lot of preachy shit going on in it.
Yeah.
It's just objectively good music. They got rained out too. And all of their shit was set up too.
Red was kind
of
dope though.
Red was dope.
Yeah.
And he didn't realize who they were at first. And then they started playing, I think it was either Already Over or, what was the song that you knew?
I have no idea.
It was, oh no, it was Breathe Into Me.
Okay.
The song that everyone knows. And he's like, oh yeah, that's that band. I'm like, yeah, that's that band. Also playing in the rain, which added
creepy stuff is equivalent to like finding out that Flyleaf's All Around Me is like religious, and you're like. Ugh.
But at the time, it was written so well that you could interpret it different ways. So even if you weren't a Christian, you could still enjoy it.
Right.
But same can't be said for like Skillet's newer stuff. I'm sorry, I still love them, but I just can't. I can't get into it.
Fair enough. Yeah.
Nor would I probably pay to see them live because I don't.
Fans of Behemoth would absolutely disagree with it.
I also probably wouldn't go to see Skillet because I don't want to see John Cooper preach for 20 minutes.
John Cooper's cool as hell. What do you mean?
He seems like a cool dude. I just.
Sounds like you got a buddy to go see Skillet with if you don't want to go by yourself.
100% go see Skillet. One of my best friends, John Volpine, he's actually done like two music videos for them.
Oh.
Awesome.
Very cool.
Yeah. I have no problem with that. JC's he's a big Marvel fan, so like, oh, yeah. You got a friend in me, buddy.
Says it straight to the camera, too. Like, you heard me. Okay, so you started playing guitar at 9. When did you get into vocals?
I picked up a bass, and I sucked at it. So I picked up a microphone after that, and I was okay. So it was enough to get my friends to go like,
at what age?
I want to say I was 15.
Okay.
15 or 16? 15. I don't know. Whenever kids think that they can do stuff and they get in a garage, and it's really hot.
Sometimes it starts at 9.
Yeah, he's a freak of nature.
I started drums first at 7. It was only because my dad was a drummer and we had the shit there.
Right.
And then one of my older brothers started taking guitar lessons from this guy who happened to also teach Chris Link, who's the guitar player from Attila, because they're from our area. And I watched my older brother do it. I was like, okay, that seems cool. I want to do that. And I started doing that at 9. But I started drums first.
Any opportunity to bring that up, by the way.
Yeah, I do.
You have to throw in the subtle flex in there, you know? It's fine.
Yeah.
I appreciate the hustle.
Go ahead. Throw it up.
You got to flex up.
Throw up that flex. You earned it. You earned it, big guy.
But all right. Okay, so no actual, like, professional training? It was just kind of like, oh, let me just try this shit out?
No, I would say only in, like, the last 4 years have I been really, really training. Only because, like, I don't know. I let too many people get in my head, and I thought I had to hide behind screaming. So I just got really good at that. And then I was like, oh, man, if I can get really good at that, I'd probably get really good at singing. And I started getting on the Dr. Vox program. And, you know, of course, like, he trained, like, Melissa Cross. And, you know, I follow Chris Lipe on YouTube, and I watch, like, a lot of his deconstruction of vocals. I've done, like, the Music Mentors program, where I basically have gone through, like, I want to say 20 hours worth of, like, vocal sessions that I went to some formal training classes with this guy, Mike Sopper, for a couple years. And, you know, it's only in the last few years I really just took it serious. Before that, it was just, like, make a bunch of noise. you know, true punk rock mentality. It was just like, I'm just gonna do it. I don't know how I'm gonna do it. I'm just gonna do it.
Make noise and break shit.
Make noise and break shit. That's, yeah, that was the motto of my 20s.
All right, good stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna get into a Reddit post so we can give advice to people who ask for it on the internet.
Oh no.
Don't do it.
Oh God. So this is a 18-year-old female saying that her boyfriend, who's also 18, keeps gaining muscle and I'm struggling with attraction to him. For context, he's a gym fanatic, started right when our relationship started about 2.5 years ago. And since then, he's gained a pretty decent amount of muscle to the point where it's starting to become unattractive to me. I've struggled with this for a while, around 4 months. 4 months is a while? And I've brought it up to him multiple times, saying I still love him, but I would struggle with being around him if he overdoes the gym thing. He told me multiple times that he won't get to that point, but he hasn't stopped, and he got to that point. Now, this is not a deal breaker for me, and I don't want to break up with him, but I'm having a very tough time initiating things between us, being around him and just being attracted to him in general. Is there any way to change this? And I'd hate to want to limit him in his favorite thing in the world, but is there a chance that he would tone it down?
How old are they?
18.
18?
His testosterone is at its absolute peak, and I can guarantee you his gains are going to drop a little bit over the next couple of years.
That's not the question that you're asking. I'm asking, like, what his physique's going to be in a couple of years.
No, but that's the point. She could wait it out.
So you have two choices, accept it or break up. There's no middle ground there. It's either you find attraction or you overlook his muscular body, which
weird thing to complain about, but okay.
I'm so sorry. I'm not making fun of you at all. It's just like that's the most opposite thing that at least social media tells you that you're supposed to go for. But if that's not your thing, but you love this person, you just kind of have to let them do their thing. Or you're 18, you're going to love, like, so many people. So break up with them and go find somebody that's exactly what you think you want.
I
want
to get a dump his ass button for these.
Dump his ass.
Dump his ass. Next question.
She added a note saying, by the way, I wanted to clear it up. It's not insecurity, that she just genuinely feels he's so intimidating that it's unattractive.
Think about how many pickle jars he can open. What do you mean? That's handy.
I feel like there's uncovered trauma.
Break up with him.
And never have a pickle again.
Have a pickle again. Yeah, you need yourself a dumpy boyfriend, and then you're going to be like, man, I can't open this jar. Yeah.
You know who could have? Your muscular boyfriend.
Ex-boyfriend.
Ex-boyfriend, yeah.
It's been 2.5 years, though, like...
And you're just now having a problem with it, like, four months ago? Like,
who cares? Let the guy go to the gym. Let him feel good. He likes it.
At least it's not meth.
Go with him. Who knows? You might have a good time.
I love how it's either gym or meth. There's no in between.
It's Florida. It's gym or meth.
Well, I mean, we don't know where these people
Welcome
are,
to
but
South
that's our
Florida.
Reality,
go to the
yes.
Gym or smoke meth.
All right, guys. Thank you for the relationship advice.
You're welcome. We're
I really do need to get the dump. Oh, you want another one?
Yeah, let's go for another one. All right. This is fun.
Okay.
I'm putting my leader hat on.
All right.
I'm going to guide people.
I love it when people ask for another question, because I feel like when I bring it up, they're like, oh, God.
No,
this,
hell no.
And then,
people ask me questions all the time.
All right.
I love answering questions.
This is another female. She's 19. Speaking of her boyfriend, she doesn't know if he's getting too possessive or if she's paranoid. So recently, my boyfriend told me that he does not like me having a public account, so I made my account private. Red flag.
Next question.
No, she goes on to mention that she gets one of those people. First, she got, like, a photographer walk up to her that was, like...
Why is he telling her to have a private account?
No, I agree.
Let me ask
wrong.
A question. Would you want a man telling you what to do?
No man tells me what to do.
Thank you.
I tell my
Break
man
up
what to
with
do.
Him.
I tell my man what to do.
Exactly. Oh, well, I mean, that's kind of the same thing.
Shh. You know, so funny story. No, I'll tell it before this is over. But, so my boyfriend, we've been dating for 8 years.
Okay.
And in the beginning of our relationship, he would go on Instagram, and a bunch of, like, half-naked girls would be on there, but it wasn't, like, random people. It was people we knew from high school.
Oh, really?
So I was like, I don't like that. Can you unfollow them? It makes me uncomfortable. Because, mm-hmm. you know, insecurities.
Yeah.
And he goes, you know what? I'm just going to delete my Instagram. So for like 5 years, off social media completely.
Okay.
Recently, like 2 months ago, makes an account. His bio says, I'm here to post pictures of my pets and support my girlfriend. I love him with all my heart. But yeah.
See, that's what keeper sounds like.
He is a keeper. make him keep his account private.
How about right? that? How about you turn your account into a pet account?
He has his little story highlights. It's mm-hmm. just each of the pets. Like, yeah. he's got two dogs and two cats. And, you know, they're all highlighted on there. It's very cute. Very wholesome. Mm-hmm. But, yeah. This is your shameless plug moment. If you guys want to plug in anything that Werewolves is doing, what do you want people to know?
Know us. Know our music. Go listen to it. I don't know.
Unfortunately, there's not a whole lot we can disclose about future plans as of right now.
It sucks. We have a lot of stuff, and I can't talk about it. And it sucks.
Can you talk about it in like 3 weeks? Because that's when this will be out.
3 weeks? Probably not.
Probably not.
Probably not. I will say there's a lot of music recorded. Like, a lot.
Yeah, so you guys went to L.A. recently.
We as a collective have been recording nonstop for 2 years now. Okay. And there is several EPs and a record's worth of material.
Put it to you this way. We went to Ohio like March or April of last year.
Yeah.
And then April. So we were there for a week.
Right after we played Escape the Fade.
That's true. So April of last year, we go to Ohio to go with our like co-producer and friend for like a week straight.
Also now manager.
Yeah. And when we got home, I downloaded Cubase, which is the DAW that he was using.
Shout out to Alex Ash.
Shout out to Alex.
We love him that way. Space alien.
I taught myself how to do pre-production and recording. So now I'm doing a lot of the writing.
Hold on. Like, you hear that and you go like, oh, yeah. But like, he learned how to do it from watching it for like 3 days and then started tracking himself. That's insane. That's, you're a freak of nature. You know that, right?
So I would. Wait, hold on.
That was another flex moment.
Come on, flex it out.
So for the first 3 days, I just sat and watched him, and then whenever they would like go downstairs to his basement to like smoke or whatever or take a break, I would just be fascinated, and I'd start doing the drum mapping.
Time out. It wasn't when we went down there. I don't smoke. I'm sober. I don't do anything. They would smoke. I like being in the presence of weed. You know, does that make sense?
Yes.
Like, I don't want to smoke it because it makes me, like, weirder than normal.
Right.
But I like being on the rotation, but not actually smoke.
You just skip it over.
Now, back to what I was saying. It's not that we were down there just, like, you know, ugh. We were having deep life conversations that turned into songs. So, like,
it's part of the creative process.
We were doing work, okay?
While they were down there doing...
Continue with your story, because you were the only one writing.
While they were down there doing work, I was training myself how to do the actual recording part. And then when we got home, I bought it and trained myself how to use it. So the songs that immediately followed that trip were Titanium and Possession. And I wrote those in my room and then brought them to them. And
Side
we
note.
Finished them.
During that whole recording process, it was fantastic because it allowed us to have more circles, which led to better lyrics.
Right.
Because he would just be up there for, like, hours just clicking and moving and playing.
They'd come up from the basement, like, 30 minutes later, and I'd have, like, all the drum mapping done, like, tuning vocals. And Alex was even like, how the fuck did you do that? I'm like, I've just watched you for the last three days straight for like 15 hours a day. I'm just sitting next to you watching it.
Right.
Like, it was easy for me to pick up on.
Now we write songs via voice notes, which, by the way, I figured out the verse in the car when I was driving up here. I'll mouth it to you.
Nice.
Beautiful.
I don't know how to play. I don't play guitar well, so I have to like literally like, I hear.
Oh, my brother was trying to do that to Siri to like figure out the name of a song because he saw somebody do it on a commercial.
That's my Siri.
And he was right.
Yeah. He's my Shazam.
I don't know. Shazam, wow. Yeah. I don't know if your intuition ever told you when you texted him that time, like, hey, do you want to, you know, join this? That he was going to be all of this to you but I'm so happy that it happened. I'm so happy you guys are all together. I've come to know about werewolves probably within the last year or so when I started this podcast, and I think you guys are so dope.
Thank you. You
guys need to follow Werewolves. You already heard it. You have a ton of new music on the way.
So much. I'll tell you more news. We have nothing.
I'm sure more shows are going to be on the way too.
I hope so.
And I'm super happy that you guys came all the way out here for me for the podcast. You guys rock.
Thank you.
And we'll catch you guys next time on a Senior Citizen podcast.